Hey everybody, it's Lon. So I've been here in Connecticut. We've got a couple of new options for internet service, one of them being Frontier, the local phone company, who wired up most of the state with fiber optic cable. My father got it first in August of 2022, and I did a full review of the service back then. And last year, my mom at her place got Frontier fiber as well. And I got a lot of comments on those videos asking how it's going, because it's been a while. So is the service still good? Yes, but keep an eye on the bill. Let's dive into this. Now, today's video is being brought to you by all of you. That includes everyone who watches and subscribes to this channel, along with those of you who contribute to the channel, either through my donor box page at Lon.TV/support, my Patreon, Floatplane, or the YouTube membership program. And of course, we now have the merch store where you can pick up a t-shirt, a polo shirt, or even a mug if you want to help the channel further, along with getting something tangible that you can show your support with. Thank you all for your continued support. And now let's dive into today's topic. Now, the good news on the Frontier service is that it is very good and very consistent insofar as bandwidth and ping rates are concerned. So everything you saw in my original video from my dad's place 2 years ago and my mom's place a year ago are still holding true today. The service has been very, very stable. In my dad's case, he lives near the beach here in Connecticut where you've got salt water and corrosion. And over there, he's had to constantly call out for cable repairs because he'd have corrosion on the connectors either outside of his house or somewhere else on the street. And it would take a while often for Comcast to chase those down and fix them. With fiber, you don't have those issues, and the service has been much more reliable for him down by the beach. Now, Frontier is using XPS-PON for their fiber optic technology. This is the same stuff that Go NetSpeed, another Connecticut fiber ISP, is using. And if you're curious as to how these networks work, we did a really fun tour with Go NetSpeed about a year ago to see what it takes to get one of these networks up and running. What's amazing is how little equipment is necessary between the customer and the central office, and how small the central office installations are. So just by nature, this is a technology that is much easier to manage for the ISP, and that translates into better service for customers. Now, my mother also subscribed to YouTubeTV through Frontier, and that's been okay. The price went up by about $10 from last year, and that's because Frontier had a one-year promotion on the monthly subscription fee. The bigger issue my mother's running into is that her Rokus are constantly logging out of the YouTube app, and I have to go back over there, reinstall the app, and get everything up and running again. It's almost like you have to reset the cookies every once in a while, and that's been a big headache for her. Not that it's hard to do, but it's something that is not something she's enjoying, and she has to go and hit the button and go through all the processes on the laptop or on the phone, and she just wants to watch television. So that's been the one downside so far in this experience. The YouTube TV service is great. It is very expensive, but getting it to work consistently has been an issue for my mom and something maybe to keep in mind for your parents if you're helping them with their internet. Now, what hasn't been great about the Frontier experience are the billing and customer service issues. When my mom first got her service set up, they screwed up her initial order. They ended up having two separate connections to her home that were established. And then when they took one of them away, they didn't close the billing account on it. So it took a lot of back and forth with customer service initially just to get the service to where it needed to be because she was trying to keep her phone number. But then the billing nonsense began. So for the first year, everything was fine. So in June of 2024, the pricing was where it was supposed to be according to their promotion. So the internet was $49.99 a month. The phone was $25 a month. The TV was $63 through YouTube TV, and then you had some taxes and fees for a grand total of $149.90. Now, she took advantage of the auto pay bill discount, which took $10 off the price of the internet during that first year. But once that 1 year period expired, things started to change. So in the June bill, she got a little note that said, our next bill will be $10 more than the previous one. And they blamed it on prices going up for everyone, and this is why they're raising the price of service. And then July came around, and sure enough, their internet went up by $10. And then on that bill, we had an important update that said the $10 auto pay discount was going to be reduced by $5 unless she connects her bank account to Frontier. My mother does not like connecting her bank account to anything. She's been using her credit card to pay. So now they dropped her discount by $5. So her cost of internet went up $15 on top of the YouTube portion of the bill going up by $10 as well at the end of that introductory period. So now she is paying $175.86. So as you can see, my mom's bill went up significantly here. And if we don't do anything about this, she'll be paying $311 more per year than she was when she started with the service, with no change in what she's getting for what she's paying. And I'm sure the YouTube thing will keep going up in price as well. So when I went in to try to use their online tools to change her service level, this is what I was presented with. And this is the kind of service you can expect from Frontier, unfortunately. I tried two different computers and three different web browsers, and I got the same error on all of them. So I'll have to pop back in later and check out this again. Or I will have to spend a lot of time on the phone with customer service, which I'm not looking forward to. Now, I did look to see what they're offering new customers now in my area, and they have a level of service that was not available when my mom and dad signed up called Fiber 200. And a viewer of the channel in the next town over from me just got this as well. He's very happy with it. As you can see, it is 200 megabit symmetrical. And if you are on a lower cost cable plan, this is a nice improvement because you get much faster upload speeds that, of course, are more reliable too. So I'm probably going to switch my mom to that plan because she doesn't need 500 megabits per second. That was just the lowest cost option that was available when she signed up. But you can see what the current pricing is. And of course, people get a 12-month introductory deal on this. Afterward, it goes up $10, and if you don't have the auto pay, it is much more expensive. Now, if we look at some of their higher-end offerings, they now have a 2, 5, and 7-gig option. Of note here, the 7-gig option at $300 a month is about the same price as what Comcast will sell you for 10 gigabits on their Gigabit Pro service. That's what I installed here now about 4 years ago. And when I got it, it was that price for only 2 gigabit symmetrical. Now it's 10 for the same price. And it's a much better Metro Ethernet connection back to Comcast versus the shared PON technology that Frontier is using. So if you're about to pull the trigger on fiber 7 gig from Frontier, call Comcast and see if you can get their Gigabit Pro service where you are, because it's a much better fiber option and it's been rock solid reliable here. But as we've talked about many times in the past, you will be hard pressed to find any internet service that you can connect to that will give you more than 2 gigs at any given time. So if you've got a lot of stuff going on at once, these higher bandwidth tiers are good, but you're not going to see this level of speed on just one provider when you're connecting for streaming and downloading and other stuff. Now, one thing that will be changing for Frontier customers is that they will all likely become Verizon customers in the near future. They are on the cusp of a $20 billion deal to have Verizon buy out Frontier's infrastructure. And what's odd about this deal is that just a few years ago, Verizon sold all their landline assets to Frontier, which put them into bankruptcy because they couldn't afford the debt on all of the old phone networks that they acquired throughout the United States. But the reason they did the deal was because the pole attachments are worth quite a bit. If you want to install an internet service provider in a community, if you can't get ready access to the telephone pole, you're out of luck. So Frontier owns a lot of poles, a number of them in my community and many others throughout the country. So they were able to leverage this after they got out of bankruptcy to start hanging fiber on the pole attachments that they already had control over, which was much easier from a regulatory process than being a startup trying to get your own spot on those poles. So now Verizon, who sold all this stuff to Frontier, is now buying it back with all this stuff added to it. And it makes you wonder, what do these phone companies do anymore? Because Verizon just threw all this stuff away, let somebody else put the infrastructure in, and then they're buying it all back, and they're probably spending more doing that than they would if they actually did the work themselves. Now, the reason why everyone's so hot to trot here can be found in a Communication Workers of America FAQ from 2020 when Frontier was exiting bankruptcy. The terms of their bankruptcy were that Frontier would be able to reduce their debt to bondholders by $11 billion. That is a lot of money that they were able to reduce in their debt load. And in exchange for that reduction, the bondholders were given stock in the new frontier company that emerged from bankruptcy. And then, of course, they started putting all the fiber in and building up the value of the company. And now those shareholders, I'm sure, are eager to get out, and they have control of the company. So that is why I think this number is as high as it is. And Verizon, I'm sure, is eager to pick up an easy win here to get a bunch of new fiber customers that they don't have to invest any infrastructure dollars in to get moving. Now, this still has to go through a few processes, one of which is approval by the shareholders of both companies, but also regulators have to approve it. And of course, the presidential election may likely have an impact on how regulators react to this deal. So there's still a lot more to come on this Verizon deal, and not everybody is bullish on it. There's been some commentary in the financial press, like this article from Barron's, talking about how this may not be such a great deal for Verizon. So there could still be some pressure from shareholders and regulators that might prevent this from happening. But until then, if you got a Frontier account, it will remain with Frontier for some time to come. Keep an eye on the bill, but if you're able to keep that under control, the service has been pretty good so far. That's going to do it for this one. Until next time, this is Lon Sieben. Thanks for watching.